In this video, we're going to be using a zener diode in order to build a shunt voltage regulator. Now, before we design the regulator, I want to review the properties of zener diodes. First, let's consider a normal diode, and then we'll consider a zener diode. A normal diode will have a forward voltage drop, which here I'm labeling V sub F, and it will pass current in the forward direction. If it's a silicon diode, then that forward voltage drop is about 0.7 volts. If it's a different kind of diode, say a germanium diode, then that forward voltage drop can be some other number, like 0.3 volts. Let's make a plot of the current versus voltage characteristics of a normal diode. If the diode were hypothetically ideal, it would look like this, and the forward voltage drop would be zero. Such a diode is either fully on or fully off. Let's now make a plot of a semi-ideal diode. If it's a silicon semi-ideal diode, then it's fully on if the forward voltage drop is 0.7 volts, and it's off otherwise. In other words, it has a turn-on voltage. I'm still calling it semi-ideal here because the slope of the line as I have it plotted is infinite. That won't happen in reality because in reality, diodes have some series resistance. How could I model that? With some series resistance added, there will be some finite slope to this line. I'll call that the realistic diode. In reality, this curve would be exponential, so the turn-on wouldn't be so sudden as I have it plotted. Let's stick with this realistic diode model, though. Basically, as the voltage gets higher, the amount of current passing through the diode will rise. How about the other side of the graph, though? What happens if we put a reverse voltage across this diode? Well, the way I have it plotted now, no current will flow, no matter how much reverse voltage I put on the diode. But of course, that's not realistic. What really happens is that if you put a large enough reverse voltage across the diode, it will break down. Let's add that to our model. The negative voltage at which this occurs is called the breakdown voltage, and I'm going to label that V sub Z. Z here just stands for zener. When it breaks down, a lot of current's going to flow in the reverse direction, but the line really shouldn't be vertical the way I have it plotted. Let's go for a more realistic model. Because I have current plotted on the vertical axis and voltage plotted on the horizontal axis, the inverse slope of this line ought to correspond to the series resistance in the reverse direction for this zener diode. This resistance tends to be fairly small, so we can use this breakdown voltage of a zener diode in order to design a voltage regulator. It gives us a voltage reference because this breakdown voltage tends to be rather stable. The circuit symbol for a zener diode is a little bit different than the circuit symbol for an ordinary diode. Although basically it's the same diode, we use a different circuit symbol just to indicate that current is ordinarily flowing in the reverse direction. Let's call the voltage drop V sub dZ. It's the zener diode voltage drop, and current's going to flow the wrong way, in a sense, through the diode. If we compare the picture of the ordinary diode on the left with the picture of the zener diode on the right, and then look at the graph in the middle, we can see that the current on the graph is just the inverse of I sub Z. The forward voltage drop is just the inverse of the reverse voltage drop. Let's now take a look at a circuit model for the zener diode that we can use when we design regulators. Current's going to flow through the zener diode in the reverse direction, but only if sufficient voltage is present in order to break down the zener diode. We can model that breakdown voltage by putting a source into our model. I've labeled this source V sub Z. This indicates that you have to have a voltage across the zener diode greater than that V sub Z in order to break down the diode. What happens if you have a voltage across the zener diode that's less than the breakdown voltage? Well, if we look back at our graph, we're going to see that no current's flowing because we'll be somewhere in this area of the graph. For example, let's say that a particular zener diode has a breakdown voltage of 3 volts. If we hook a 1 volt source up to it, is any current going to flow? Well, no. There's insufficient voltage to break down the diode. What happens if I apply a voltage to the zener diode that's greater than the breakdown voltage? Well, in that case, the series resistance in the reverse direction of the zener diode would start to matter. The more current you flow through the diode, the greater the voltage drop will be. The third component here in the model that I'd like to draw your attention to is this diode. You might be wondering, why is this diode pointed opposite to the diode that we're trying to model? What this diode is an ideal diode to indicate that current is only flowing from left to right through this model. If current were to flow from right to left, that would be current flowing the correct way through a forward bias diode. That's not properly modeled by this breakdown voltage that I have here inside the box. how would we model current flowing in the forward direction through the diode? In the forward bias direction, the diode would have a forward drop, say 0.7 volts. It would have some series resistance associated with the slope of this line in the forward direction. The fact that current can only flow right to left in that particular model is then indicated by another ideal diode up here. When using the zener diode, it's uncommon for current to flow in the correct way through the diode, so we're going to mostly ignore this part of the model. When designing our shunt regulator, I might also sometimes neglect to draw this forward biased ideal diode here. I'd now like to introduce our zener shunt regulator circuit. We're going to assume here at the input side that we have a DC source, but it's unregulated, meaning the voltage might vary a little bit. The voltage that we're going to get at the output is going to drive our load. Now, the key to making this work is that the input unregulated voltage, no matter how much it swings up or down at the input side, always has to be greater than the voltage that we plan to deliver to the load. If the voltage at the input side swings too low, below the zener breakdown voltage, for example, then we're going to have trouble maintaining the correct output voltage. Our strategy is to make sure that the zener diode is always broken down. That will fix the voltage at approximately the breakdown voltage of the zener diode, which is relatively stable. The R sub S in the circuit diagram might represent the source impedance if the source impedance is fairly large. If the source impedance is too small, you might have to add another resistor in order to make the source impedance artificially a little bit larger. The reason for having this resistor here is that we need to drop the voltage in between our input voltage and our load voltage. This limits the current through the zener diode. If we look over at the equivalent circuit diagram, we can see the directions that the current flows in the circuit. Since the input voltage is always going to be larger than the output voltage or the load voltage, we're going to have current moving generally from left to right in this diagram. Let's call this current up here the source current, and then let's call the current through the load current, I sub L. The current down through the zener diode is going to change as a function of the input voltage. If the input voltage rises, without the zener diode, the voltage across the load would increase. But what we're going to do here is have the zener diode absorb the extra current. So what we'll eventually have is a situation where larger input voltages result in a larger zener current flowing. Smaller input voltages result in a smaller zener current flowing, such that in either case, you get a very constant load voltage. Let me show you how it works. Let's analyze the circuit. Let's apply the Kirchhoff current law at this node. We have one current coming into the node and two currents coming out of the node. Let's apply Ohm's law across resistor R sub S in order to calculate that first current. Current is voltage drop divided by resistance. The diode down here is ideal. We can apply Ohm's law across the series resistance of our zener diode in order to find current I sub Z. There's the voltage drop across that resistor, and there we have the resistance. Let's multiply everything in this equation by R sub Z, R sub S. Let me now multiply all of these terms out. Now I want to gather all the V sub L terms on the left side. Let's then move this V sub I term over to the right and write out everything else. Let's now divide everything in this equation by this term in order to find the load voltage in terms of everything else. If we look carefully at this term next to I sub L, we see that this is just R sub S in parallel with R sub Z. We now have an equation that relates the load voltage to the input voltage and all of the circuit components. Why does this function as a voltage regulator? Well, if we look at the terms, we can see that if the zener diode series resistance R sub Z is small relative to the resistor R sub S, then some of these terms can be neglected. The first term has an R sub Z in the numerator, so we can neglect it. The second term has an R sub Z in the denominator. This causes the R sub S to cancel in the numerator and the denominator. It's just V sub Z. Over here in the third term, we note that these two resistors are effectively in parallel. A small resistor in parallel with a large resistor is just a small resistor. The term is thus small, and we can neglect it. We've now reached the key equation. The load voltage is just the zener diode's breakdown voltage. It's not related to the input voltage. That's why it functions as a voltage regulator. Something I need to point out about voltage regulators in general, though, is that they might not be very efficient. That's certainly the case with this voltage regulator. If the input voltage is high and the output voltage is not so high, then what accounts for the voltage drop? Well, the series resistance R sub S and the zener diode simply burn up power in order to lower down the voltage. Burning up power in order to stabilize voltage is routinely done to make voltage regulators, but it's certainly not the most efficient way to do it. A more efficient kind of regulator would be a switching regulator, but that would be the subject of a different video. In a previous video, I talked about voltage regulators, and I mentioned that a voltage regulator has three very important characteristics. Firstly, it provides a very stable DC voltage that's independent of the load, independent of the AC line voltage, and also independent of temperature. But how can we quantify how good a voltage regulator is? This brings us to stabilization. First of all, a good regulator needs to be independent of the load current. Let's relate a change in the load voltage to a change in the load current with R sub zero. It's going to have the unit of resistance. Furthermore, if there's a change in the line voltage or the input voltage, that's going to show up as a change in the load voltage. Let's relate these two with a proportionality factor, S sub V. Likewise, if you heat up the regulator or you cool it off, you might expect the load voltage to change. Let's relate the change in temperature to the change in load voltage with this proportionality factor, S sub T. R sub zero is called the output resistance. S sub V is called the input regulation factor. Input because it's related to the AC line voltage at the input side of the circuit. And finally, S sub T is called the temperature coefficient. We want all of these to be zero. In the ideal case, they wouldn't have any value at all. The load voltage would not change at all if they're zero. Of course, in reality, they're not going to be zero, but we hope that they're very small numbers. I now want to rewrite each of these factors in terms of the change in the load voltage. The output resistance is just the change in the load voltage with respect to changes in the load current. However, it's normally measured when there aren't any other changes, so I'd better specify that we don't have any temperature changes at the same time, and we don't have any changes in the line voltage. Similarly, the input regulation factor relates changes in the load voltage to changes in the line voltage, but that's typically measured when the temperature is being held constant and the load current is also constant. Similar to the other two, the temperature coefficient is normally measured when both the line and the load are held constant. Only the temperature is changing here. Let's now return to our zener diode shunt regulator and find expressions for each of these three proportionality factors. We've already derived an equation that expresses our load voltage in terms of our line voltage and characteristics of the diode and the rest of the circuit. Furthermore, we've just derived expressions for each of these three constants. If we only look at small changes and we take note here of the fact that we're only changing one variable at a time, then we can just use the partial derivative of our expression for the load voltage in order to find each of these three factors. The first two terms don't have any I sub L, so we're left only with the third term. Our line voltage only appears once in this equation. It's thus easy to take the partial derivative. In order to take the derivative with respect to temperature, we have to understand which of the variables in the equation actually depends on the temperature. Although in principle, temperature can affect everything in this equation, the term that it affects the most is the zener diode junction voltage. That means it's going to show up mostly in the V sub Z term. The first derivative is apparent from our equation. It's just the term sitting next to the V sub Z. The second term can't be found out from the equation, so I'm just going to indicate it as a constant. We would have to either measure it or get it from the data sheet of the zener diode. What can we say about all of these constants? Well, as I pointed out before, if the zener diode resistance R sub Z is small, it forces the circuit to be more perfect. As we can see, if the zener diode resistance is small, this term goes to zero, this term goes to zero, and also this term goes to just theta ZT, which is the best we can do. What are some limitations of this circuit? We might end up with a lot of current passing down through the zener diode in the reverse direction. That can be problematic if you expect very high input voltages and moderate or low output voltages. We also have a situation where there might be quite a lot of power burned up in the pass resistor R sub S right here. These two shortcomings effectively limit the current passing through the load resistor to a few tens of milliamps. In order to improve it, we'll need to look at a different kind of voltage regulator, the series regulator. Before I get to the series regulator, though, in the next video, I'd like to look at the topics of line and load regulation.